Tantor Audio, a division of recorded books, presents Jesus, A Very Short Introduction by Richard Bauckham. Narrated by Julian Elfer. Preface. Writing a book about Jesus is a daunting task. One could not begin to do justice to a figure who has, for many centuries, evoked the devotion of billions, and in the last two centuries has been subjected to intense scholarly examination and debate. When I planned the book, I decided that its focus must be the historical Jesus of the Gospels, which is probably what most listeners will expect. But that is not the place to survey the many different approaches and results to be found in contemporary Jesus scholarship. I certainly do not want my listeners to be unaware that there are many such, and that the approach I take in this book is as controversial as any of the others. But rather than sketching many approaches inadequately, it seemed to me best to tell it as I see it. Essentially, this means reading the Gospels as versions of the history of Jesus, and by history I mean the sort of history people wrote in the ancient world, in the context of all that we know of the first century context in which Jesus actually lived. I take the Gospels to be based substantially on the testimony of the eyewitnesses who had known Jesus in his lifetime, and I briefly indicate the rationale for such an approach in Chapter 2, on sources. Rather than a minimal Jesus, reconstructed on the basis of a rather small selection of the data in the Gospels, as represented in many of the current scholarly accounts of the historical Jesus, I have tried to take seriously the different ways in which the four Gospels themselves portray Jesus. I take their differences to be an advantage. They give us more than one angle on a complex figure. I have not imagined that we can strip Jesus of all interpretation and get back to mere brute facts, or to more than a few facts that would be of little interest if they were all we knew. But I do think the Gospels give us access to the way Jesus was perceived by those who were close to him, people who experienced the events from the inside and whose own lives were deeply affected by them. This seems to me a kind of knowledge of Jesus that is well worth having, whatever we choose to do with it. Richard Bauckham. Chapter 1. Jesus, a Universal Icon. Jesus of Nazareth, or Jesus Christ, as Christians call him, is undoubtedly the best known and most influential human person in world history. 2 billion people today identify themselves as Christians, with the implication that Jesus is the focus of their relationship to God and of their way of living in the world. Such followers of Jesus are now more numerous and make up a greater proportion of the world's population than ever before. It is estimated that they are increasing by some 70,000 persons every day. This growth of Christianity is taking place despite its decline in the West, especially in Western Europe, and those who think the figure of Jesus Christ is of fading significance need to reckon with the astonishingly rapid increase in numbers of Christian believers in other parts of the world, such as Africa and, who would have expected it, China. Jesus is plainly no longer an icon purely of Western culture, but in fact he never was. He lived in the Middle East, and in the first few centuries of Christianity, the faith spread in all directions. Not only to Greece and Rome, France and Spain, but also to Egypt, North Africa and Ethiopia, to Turkey and Armenia, to Iraq, Persia, and India. Christianity was a world religion long before it was a European one. Thus, Jesus has never been confined to Western religion and culture. In fact, no other figure has so extensively crossed the cultural divisions of humanity and found a place in so many diverse cultural contexts. When Jesus has been used to legitimate domination and oppression, very often the oppressed, like the black slaves of the American South, have been energized to resist by the solidarity of Jesus with them. While in the modern period Christianity has been all too easily identified with Western imperialism and colonialism, or with the spread of Western culture, the figure of Jesus himself has had a way of escaping these associations. The search for an African Jesus, an Indian Jesus, a Japanese Jesus goes on, while people inspired by Jesus continue to find him in the poor, the sick, and the dying, wherever and whoever they are. Jesus is not even confined to Christianity. He is a figure of significance in Islam, a messenger of God who appears in the Quran. Many Hindus and Buddhists have interpreted him favorably within the perspectives of their own traditions. Recently, some Jewish thinkers have been reclaiming Jesus as an authentically Jewish teacher. There have been appreciative Marxist readings of Jesus. There are New Age versions of Jesus. Moreover, respecting Jesus while denouncing the church has become a common attitude in the secular West. He is usually exempted from the charge that religion is a bad influence, promoting bigotry and violence. It is still advantageous to claim Jesus as support for one's cause, though more so in the United States than in Britain or Northern Europe. No other individual has inspired so much art, literature, music, and even film. There are the wonderfully varied traditions of visual portrayal of Jesus in Byzantine and Russian icons, in Ethiopian church art, in the sculpture and stained glass of the medieval West, in Renaissance painting, in the Christian art of Africa, Latin America, and India. But such has been the impact of the figure of Jesus that it has gone far beyond exclusive or explicit portrayal of Jesus, the Lord or Savior. In art, he may stand for universal humanity. His passion and death may convey the message that Calvary is everywhere. The peculiar horrors of modern history may find expression in a crucifix. In literature, there are innumerable Christ figures with sufficient family resemblance to be readily recognizable as such. Such art and literature may be unconnected with religious faith, but still bear the imprint of the doctrine of the Incarnation, that is, of the Christ who identifies with all humanity, sharing the common humanity and the common plight of all people. Despite the profound forgetfulness of Jesus in the popular culture of contemporary Europe, people still connect with his story when it is told. Jesus films are invariably controversial, but can be very successful nonetheless, as can Jesus musicals. Even a small sampling of this historical and contemporary wealth of images of Jesus reveals their stunning variety. Has Jesus in the end become no more than an empty vessel that can be filled with any sort of content? It is not surprising that among all the images, there are some very strange ones that have little resemblance to others. In the 1960s, Dead Sea Scrolls scholar John Allegro proposed that Jesus was actually a hallucinogenic mushroom. Such curiosities from the lunatic fringe of Jesus' speculation come and go and are forgotten. But what, for example, of the many African portrayals of a black Christ? To understand these, one should realize that there is no intention of suggesting that Jesus the Jew who lived in Palestine in the first century was actually a black African. What is being expressed is the connection, perceived in African Christian faith, between Jesus the universal Savior and black people. What is being portrayed is the loving solidarity of Christ who identifies in love with all people, black people included. This example suggests at least part of the explanation of the variety of images of Jesus in the different periods and cultural contexts of Christianity. These images express the relevance that the figure of Jesus was felt to have in different contexts. The exceptionally tortured and bloody portrayals of the suffering Christ in the late medieval period belong to a society ravaged by plague and war. Believers found in Christ a God who came to be with them in their pain. But such an emphasis would not have been possible had the Gospels not portrayed Jesus as having suffered and died in excruciating pain. At least within the mainstream Christian traditions, such images of Christ were always inspired and resourced by the Gospels. They portray not just a figure anyone could imagine or desire, but the Christ of the Gospels as he seemed most closely to connect with believers in that time and place. From the perspective of Christian faith, such a procedure has its dangers. What to make, for example, of the Aryan Christ of the German Christians of the Nazi period? Some images of Jesus so distort the Christ of the Gospels as to be unrecognizable as him. They are an ideological abuse of Jesus, putting him to uses wholly inconsistent with the figure to be found in the Gospels. So the Gospels have always been not only a resource, but also a means of critique of images of Jesus. And since the images can never portray more than one aspect of the depth and complexity of the Jesus of the Gospels, Christians have gone back to them constantly in order to fund their imagination of Jesus from the wealth of stories and sayings to be found there. In the end, it is the four Gospels in the New Testament that have inspired, directly or indirectly, virtually every image of Jesus, both within the church and outside. It makes sense for our strategy in this book to go back to the Gospels and to draw from them our picture of Jesus as he was in history. But here we also encounter another phenomenon, the quest of the historical Jesus in scholarly research over the last two centuries. Many scholars have sought the Jesus of history not in the Gospels as such, but by excavating the history behind the Gospels and reconstructing a picture of the real Jesus from what they regard as the more historically reliable material in the Gospels. We shall take up this issue in the next chapter. Chapter 2. The Sources. The account of Jesus in this book will be based on the view that the four Gospels in our New Testament are substantially reliable sources for knowing quite a lot about Jesus. This is a controversial view that is contested by many scholars. In this chapter, I shall sketch my reasons for taking it, but it is worth saying at the start that to some extent the proof of this pudding is in the eating. Listeners may not be equipped to adjudicate for themselves the detailed historical arguments that go into the making of any account of Jesus, but they can tell whether the result is a coherent and convincing portrait of a remarkable historical figure. They can also appreciate that history is never a mere collection of facts, but an exercise in interpretation. Our earliest and best sources for knowing about Jesus are already interpretations. There is no way they could not be. Even the people who knew and first talked about him to others were interpreting him. They could not have talked about him otherwise. But this does not mean there is no difference between good history and bad history, or that one interpretation is as good as another. We all know there is a difference between newspaper reports that are based on careful and accurate investigation, and those that, for reasons of carelessness or bias or the pursuit of sensationalism, grossly distort the facts. In the first case, we know that the reporter is telling us how she sees it, but we trust that she is honestly and intelligently and with well-honed skills providing an account that does justice to the evidence. The Four Gospels and the Other Gospels. Many people in contemporary Western society have recently gained the impression that the four Gospels in the New Testament are rather unreliable sources for knowing much about Jesus, and that there are other sources that give a very different and more trustworthy picture. Dan Brown's amazingly successful novel, The Da Vinci Code, popularized this view, though he certainly didn't invent it. Many people who may never have read any of the Gospels now think the so-called Gnostic Gospels contain the real truth about Jesus. The Gnostic Gospels became known after their discovery at Nag Hammadi in Egypt in 1945-6. It will be a useful introduction to both bodies of literature to compare and contrast, on the one hand, the New Testament Gospels of Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, and on the other hand, the Gnostic Gospels attributed to Mary, Thomas, Judas, and others. Besides these Gospels that can be rather loosely called Gnostic, there were other Gospels more like the New Testament Gospels, but only fragments of them have survived. First, what sort of books are they? In terms of literary genre, the four New Testament Gospels and the Gnostic Gospels are very different kinds of work. The four Gospels all tell a continuous narrative about the historical person Jesus, beginning either with the outset of his public career or with his birth, continuing until his death on a Roman cross, and ending with accounts either of the discovery that his tomb was empty or of his appearances after death. Within such an overall narrative framework, stories of Jesus' activity and his teachings, whether in public or to his disciples, are collected. This is the kind of work that early readers or hearers would have identified as a biography, the life of a famous person, though ancient biographies did not have all the characteristics we associate with modern biographies. The Gnostic Gospels are very different. There is very little narrative and no attempt to tell the story of Jesus' historical life. Most are set after the resurrection of Jesus and portray the risen Christ teaching his disciples, or a few or one of them, in long discourses or dialogues. We could call them revelation discourses. Most of these works tell or imply the Gnostic myth of redemption, according to which this material world was made by an ill-intentioned demigod who bungled the job. Jesus was a supernatural emissary from the unknown high God, the Father, who came to enlighten those human beings, the Gnostics, who are trapped in this material world but truly belong with the Father in his transcendent world. Jesus brings them the knowledge of their true identity. The Gnostic Christ was not really human, but merely adopted human forms in order to appear in this world. He did not, for example, die. So verbal revelation, not human history, is what interested the Gnostics. Whereas the four Gospels provide a richly detailed portrait of a real human life in a specific time and place, The Gnostic Gospels abstract the figure of Jesus into an almost purely mythical world. Secondly, however, the Gnostic Gospels do presuppose that the story and sayings of Jesus before his resurrection were well known. Their attitude to the well-known teaching of Jesus is that it was inferior teaching for the general public, or that its real esoteric meaning was not made known at the time. The Gnostic Gospels report Jesus' real message, his esoteric teaching, to the disciples, which had then been transmitted secretly to the Gnostic teachers of the second century. In order to find a place for this additional, secret teaching in the well-known story of Jesus, the Gnostic Gospels take advantage of the fact that, according to that story, Jesus did teach his disciples after the resurrection. The New Testament Gospels, however, report little of what he said. This was an obvious opportunity for later writers who wished to attribute more teaching to Jesus, especially if it was to be depicted as special, esoteric teaching for the disciples alone. The Gnostic Gospels, therefore, were designed to add. They are subsequent to the four Gospels, not only chronologically, but also logically. Thirdly, another striking contrast between the two sorts of gospel is that the four Gospels connect the story of Jesus closely with the story of Israel in the Hebrew Bible. The God whom Jesus calls Father is the God of Israel, and Jesus identifies strongly with the people of Israel. The four Gospels depict him as the Messiah of Israel, who is also the Messiah for the non-Jewish nations. The Gnostic Gospels sharply disconnect Jesus from the story of Israel for a very good reason. For them, the Old Testament God is the inferior creator of this material world, from whose power the Gnostic is to be delivered by the enlightenment Jesus brings from the true supreme God, a God not known to the Hebrew Bible. Inevitably, the Jewishness of Jesus, which is integral to his portrayal in the four Gospels, disappears from the Gnostic Gospels. Finally, a key consequence of these differences is that the Gnostic Gospels scarcely attempt to set Jesus in a real historical context. Their few attempts to do so are clearly derivative and sometimes erroneous, whereas the four Gospels embed their narrative of Jesus in an historical context that can be verified. The Jesus of these Gospels belongs to the Palestinian Jewish world of the early 1st century AD, with its religious customs and rules, its factions and beliefs, its religious and political leaders, its uneasy subjection to Roman authority, even its farming practices. The four Gospels present a Jesus who is thoroughly credible within his time and place. They have every appearance of being good history. The Gnostic Gospels do not. There is just one of the Gospels found at Nag Hammadi, the Gospel of Thomas, that has more of a claim to be taken seriously as an historical source for Jesus, and some scholars do take it seriously. Though it is scarcely more historical context than the others, it consists of a collection of sayings of Jesus, many of which resemble those in the four Gospels. In my view, it is best explained as a selection of sayings of Jesus that could be interpreted in a Gnostic way. It may transmit some of these sayings independently of the four Gospels, but its value is very uncertain. Are the four Gospels good sources? The key question for assessing the historical value of the New Testament Gospels is, how did these traditions about Jesus, the stories and sayings, reach the authors of the Gospels? Jesus probably died in AD 30, though some scholars argue for AD 27 or 33, and what is probably the earliest of the four Gospels, Mark's, is usually thought to have been written around AD 65 to 75. Matthew's and Luke's Gospels date from at least a little later in the first century, while John's Gospel, almost certainly the last of the four to be written, or at least completed, is probably to be dated in the last decade of the century. A large majority of scholars think that Matthew and Luke used Mark as a major source of their own work, though they drew extensively on other sources as well. So a few decades separate the events of Jesus' career from the Gospels. What happened to the traditions about him during that period? For a century, Gospels scholarship has been dominated by a particular answer to that question that was given by a few eminent scholars called the form critics early in the 20th century. In my view, the form critics set mainstream Gospels scholarship on a false track, but only quite recently have a number of scholars seriously undertaken to correct the form critics' mistakes. Absolutely fundamental for the form critics' approach was their conviction that the Gospels are folk literature, derived from oral traditions which they compared with the material studied by the folklorists of their day. Oral tradition, they thought, was formed and transmitted by the folk, not by individuals, and the communities that valued such folklore had no interest of any kind in history. By analogy, the Jesus traditions were anonymous community traditions passed down in the early Christian communities, not connected to individuals such as those who had been eyewitnesses of Jesus' history, but only to the local Christian community itself. They were transmitted not by people concerned to relate past history, but for purposes orientated solely to the community's present, and could therefore be freely modified or even created de novo in accordance with the community's present needs. This view of the way that traditions about Jesus reach the writers of the Gospels has made it very difficult to use the Gospels as historical sources for knowing about the real historical Jesus. While some scholars have argued that the oral transmission of traditions preserved them rather faithfully, others have thought that much of the material in the Gospels must be attributed to the early church rather than to Jesus. In any case, it would certainly not be taken for granted that the Jesus of the Gospels, or the Jesuses of the four Gospels, really corresponds with the so-called historical Jesus, the Jesus who actually lived in first century Jewish Palestine. Reconstructing this historical Jesus became a difficult task, requiring each story and each saying in the Gospels to be individually assessed for its authenticity. Scholars have devised and debated various criteria for distinguishing authentic and inauthentic material in the Gospels. The results have been very disappointing because scholars pursuing this enterprise have come up with not one, but many different historical Jesuses. One book about the historical Jesus recently listed some of the options. An eschatological prophet, a Galilean holy man, an occultic magician, an innovative rabbi, a trance-inducing psychotherapist, a Jewish sage, a political revolutionary, an Essene conspirator, an itinerant exorcist, an historicized myth, a proto-liberation theologian, a peasant artisan, a Torah observant Pharisee, a cynic-like philosopher, a self-conscious eschatological agent, a socio-economic reformer, a paradoxical messianic claimant, and one who saw himself as the very embodiment of Yahweh, God. James K. Bielby and Paul Rhodes Eddy, editors, The Historical Jesus, Five Views, London, SPCK, 2010, page 53. Admittedly, some of these are much more plausible than others, and they are not all mutually exclusive, but the fact that such diverse results have come out of the quest of the historical Jesus, conducted on form-critical premises, does not inspire confidence in the historical methods being used. The major problem is that each story and each saying has to be individually assessed for its authenticity, but we simply do not have the means to adequately do this in most cases. Each scholar makes their own selection of authentic material and constructs an historical Jesus on that basis. The selections often seem fairly arbitrary, or else trapped in a vicious circle in which the sort of...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.